story between B.B. King and I mean, like, I mean, been told a million times, but I met B.B. King when I was 12 years old. And I met him at a show in Rochester, New York. I got booked to open up for him. And I'm not sure if he'd ever seen the likes of me before, like this kid with ADD running around the stage with a Fender Telecaster and a cowboy hat. So he was probably intrigued. And I think I played okay. I mean, I wasn't, but I think I get more credit for it now than I did back in the day. But he was very nice to me, and he invited me on some more shows that summer, and was able to kind of, you know, put that together. And you know, I just, to me, it was such a real pleasure and an honor to befriend him. And he's also one of my favorite blues guys. You know, you're talking about the great voice of B.B. King, you know, the great shows. I mean, I remember one show at the Hampton Beach Casino Ballroom, 1990. It made me cry. I was a kid and I was crying. I didn't know why, but I was. You know, when he sang Guess Who? And again, it goes back to the horns and the voice. And I really admire that man for his commitment to keeping the music going and his just generosity with not only myself, but everybody else. I've never met anybody in the music business that nobody has a bad word to say about. It's a very hard thing to do, especially being in the music business 60 years. And B.B. King is blues. Blues is B.B. King. He defines the genre of music. He is the genre of music. But he also knows that for it to survive another 100 years and beyond, there has to be a new generation. So he's very conscious of nurturing that and giving advice and a stage and friendship to those who go out there and give it a go. And he says, it doesn't matter. You know, it's like, you give it a go and you like what you do. You know, Keb Moe is, you know, Robert Cray. Those are the torchbearers for the next generations, you know, and you know, the, you know, we're just guitar players. Oh, we actually have PA.
Yeah, we figured it'd be a good
idea. Nice. What's that to like? What's not to like?
No, the guitar just wasn't getting loud enough.
But yeah,
you
know, yeah. So.
You go, what's not to like? I go, the bill.
The bill.
Roy's got a thing about this place.
The story of Joe and Roy, it goes back to about 1990, 1991. And yeah, he saw me on television.
So the way I found Joe was that NBC in the United States did one of those primetime news stories back in the day. It's called Real Life. And somebody at my company actually saw Joe on TV and knew that I was into Stevie Ray Vaughan, Eric Clapton. I loved these, and I was trying to sign acts. And they said, they came into my office the next day and they said, I saw this kid on TV. He's a great prodigy. He has great vibrato. And, you know, we were looking to sign something at that time when I was looking to sign acts in that genre.
And we didn't know what to expect. We're just, you know, a bunch of upstate New York, you know, guitar guys, you know. My father, a guitar dealer, guitar player. We're just, you know, simple family, you know. And we were on TV because I played blues. And we were on TV because I met B.B. King. And national television comes out. And apparently people, you know, people at NBC thought it was an interesting feel-good story for their program, Real Life with Jane Pauley.
Chased him down, found out his name from NBC. My wife and I, at that time my fiance, drove up to Utica, New York, to meet Joe and his family after being on national TV. Of course, at that point, there was 6 or 7 lawyers and managers all knocking on his parents' door to come meet the family, which they did.
We were getting phone calls from record companies 30 minutes. Because we were listed in the phone book. We were the only Bonamasses in the Utica phone book.
And I was one of those 6 or 7. It took about 3 or 4 weeks after I met the family when they went through this interview process to decide who they wanted to, you know, be with.
So Roy came up about a week after to meet us from Florida.
Yeah, I remember going up to the house at the time, and he lived in Utica. I walked in the house, his mother and father, you know, small house, asked us into the kitchen. you know, the house smelled of coffee. She just put a fresh pot of coffee on. And I remember sitting there in front of the family and just saying to myself, what a normal family and how nice these people are, right? And long story short, I mean, after they made the decision to join or to work with our company and me and my father at that time, it's been a great relationship ever since, one that's filled with trust, and which is what is, I think, the key ingredient to our success.
We've been, you know, family for, you know, as long as I can remember.
Joe and I, after 22 years together, we have what we like to joke that we have board meetings. You know, we could have a board meeting anywhere within 30 seconds and make a major decision. And we think that's one of the keys to our success as well, because, you know, we make sure we get things done and we keep things moving forward in a positive manner.
And I sit here in the position that I'm in solely because of Roy Wiseman and his family, Elliot and Eric, because of their commitment and Roy's ability to reinvent what the music business is, even though at one point it felt like the entire music business was against us. And it just started with myself and my willingness to go out there and do 13 shows in a row in Germany and kill myself and lug my own gear and then go home, spend a day off, and then go tour the United States for 7 weeks, play to collectively 500 people, and then hopefully be able to pay the rent that month. It was Roy who saw the spark and saw the drive and saw the little bit of growth. Oh, we had 45 people here. Last time we had 20. That's good. It's hard to keep positive when the rooms are empty. And not many artists and managers go their whole careers together, you know? And Roy and I have shared the same vision. And it's this blind belief in ourselves that if you can dream it up, if you can dream it up and go, you know, we're going to make it there one day. We're going to try to do this, or we're going to kill ourselves trying. You know, that he and I have been on the same path for years, going, there's got to be a better way. The music industry is wrong. The naysayers are wrong, and it's not impossible.
Well, J stands for Joe, R stands for Roy, N stands for me, I guess.
The Kevin Shirley story is like a stool. You can't have a stool stand up unless you have at least three legs. Some stools have three legs, some stools have four legs. Our stool is Joe, myself, and Kevin Shirley. And that is what makes this thing stand up and be strong. Kevin Shirley was the third piece to this puzzle that once we got involved with Kevin, it all really started to make sense.
Now we've just had a wonderful, you know, we had a very interesting relationship. It started off as a creative arrangement where they gave me a lot of trust, you know, with the creativity and the creation going forward.
When I had originally got introduced to Kevin, and we were talking on the phone the first time, getting to know each other and setting up a meeting for him and Joe. He expressed he was looking for something outside the mainstream record business. He had been working, doing a lot of major label projects and with big budgets. And it was getting a little too contrived for him at that time. He was looking for something a little bit more organic. And I said, well, if you're looking for something organic, you come to the right place, because there's nothing more organic, and this is 6 or 7 years ago, than Joe Bonamassa and I.
To be honest, in the beginning, Roy and I bumped heads a lot. I mean, last time we were at Royal Albert Hall, we were nose to nose about an hour before we went on stage. I mean, we nearly we nearly had a physical fight, but we've really, it's a whole new model that we're working on. We're always trying to, we're always trying to create new ways to make this business, music business, work, because it's a tough business to make work. It's the old model doesn't work, in the old days, the old model worked, even though the record companies and the promoters stole so much from the artists. But now, it's become even so much more difficult because records are not being sold and product is not being sold. So we have to find new ways of making people interested in the product without losing any of the integrity of an artist like him, because he is not a pop artist. He has no desire to be a pop artist. He has no desire to be in pop culture. He's a super talented, gifted musician. We break through some of these ceilings of the genre, Blues doesn't have to stop at Muddy Waters and Howling Wolf. Hopefully we can do something that will put him in the same category and we can change the boundaries a little bit.
That sounds like something we should, consider doing together. Let's make a record and get you involved with the Joe thing. I said, look, at J&R Ventures, we're looking to bring someone in long term. I'm not into changing producers from record to record. We're a family business, and we're looking to find somebody who can musically fit in with Joe and help us grow over the long term, because we don't like change, and we need somebody to be that third leg on the stool for us creatively. And so that was the philosophy. And, we hoped that would end up being the case, and here we are 6-7 years later. Still together, making our sixth record together. Without Kevin Shirley, I don't think we'd be where we are right now. He's one of the most essential parts of the project, and he's like a brother to me, somebody I trust implicitly, and to Joe. And it's awesome when we get together, because it's very pure. The three of us get together, we have goals, we have objectives, and no politics, and a lot gets done. And so I'm happy to say that we can look at our past that we have had together and what we've accomplished and be proud of our work that we've done. And so Kevin is a very, very important part of J&R Ventures and everything that we do. And he really helps us, achieve our goals.
Kevin produces the record. This is the order of things. I play the guitar and sing. I write the songs, some of them. I play the live shows. That's my area of expertise. I put together, that's my position in the company. I'm the traveling salesman. I play the guitar and hopefully sing in tune. Kevin produces the records, essentially is the creative director. Where it's his vision. It's his, and he knows in me that I'm a willing candidate. Now there's certain things that he goes, can we do this song today? I'm like, when we did Shepherd's Bush, could we do this song? I'm like, we didn't learn it. I've learned 60 songs this week. Please don't do this. You'll break me, And he knows when it's enough. And he produces the records. He A&Rs the records. And he basically drills the band, into playing the right stuff, And it's a brutal process. And he knows he doesn't make friends doing it. But he does it because he wants the music right. And it's, that's part of the job of a great producer. Roy's the business guy. Roy, it's his vision, his marketing. It's his vision on how to get it out to as many people as possible. Everything is simpatico. Everybody has their area of expertise and it all fits in. There's no overlapping and there's no ego. Nobody's trying to tell me how to play guitar. Nobody's trying to tell Kevin how to produce, tell Roy how to market. And it really works. And I'm not sure, that it's a unique set of characters that works. And we're just crazy enough and blindly believe in this thing enough to have it work out. We never doubt it. It's just go, okay, let's do it. And if we fail, fine. It's either success or Hindenburg. The worst thing you can ever tell me is average. It was okay. That means it was average. It's like crash and burn or succeed. Leading up to this, I go, why am I doing this? You know, why am I doing this to myself?
Good question. Well, first of all, Joe is a workaholic and he's a perfectionist. And I think we all know that by how he handles himself and how he performs. You know, last summer, Kevin and I were in Montreux and we were talking about the next project of what we were going to do with Joe. And somehow the conversation morphed into that, what a great opportunity to record these four shows, these four concerts in London, and that it would be almost like a end of a chapter and the beginning of a new one, that this would be a perfect time to capture and let Joe perform a majority of his catalog that he's recorded over the last, you know, 12 years, and do it live and do it for his fans.
So when we were doing the Vienna acoustic show, Roy, Joe's manager, and I went out for lunch. And I thought it might be a good idea if we didn't do an album in 2014, and if we, in 2013, and if we did something else where I know that they want the product, and I know that that's part of their business model is to have product that's turning over. It's the only way they can really keep things going. It was just, it was like then they had booked the gigs first. They had booked these four gigs in London, and it didn't make any sense to me why anybody would want to, other than the hardcore fans, go and see all four of the same show in different venues.
We had the four shows booked in London. We were going to do the Borderline. And this was last summer while we were debuting the acoustic band in Vienna. Another challenge, if you want to say. You know, arguably the greatest jazz festival ever. You know, on special invitation from Claude Knobbs, rest in peace. 20 acoustic songs I've never sang before. A band that we only met 72 hours prior. And only nothing but a lot of money and your reputation on the line. What could go right, you know? I mean, anyway, we were sitting outside at a really lovely Thai restaurant in the afternoon, the day of the show. And I was very nervous. It was like, you know, I was like, oh man, this is rough, you know. I'm trying to remember the lyrics, and we're sitting down, and a lot of challenges on that day in Vienna, you know, and that was in Montreux. So Kevin leans over, and he goes, what are you going to do about London?
So I thought, well, why don't we change things up a bit and do things a little more challenging and give people, you know, more of a show.
I'm like, oh, Kevin, as I get my noodle bowl, right? And I'm kind of a little starstruck too, because Taj Mahal's sitting next to us. He was on the bill with us that night. And I never met him, and I never introduced myself because I was a little bit timid and a little overwhelmed with my situation. I'm about to debut this acoustic band, there's a lot of pressure. And he comes up and he goes, so what are you going to do with the London shows? And I said, I'm just trying to remember the words to Richmond, you know, and Around the Bend, and songs I've never sang live before. I go, I'm not sure. He goes, here's what I think you should do. Not to pile it on or anything. And I said, oh, sure, here we go. He goes, I think we should get four different shows, four different bands, four different set lists, four different nights, culminating at the Royal Albert Hall.
Typically, he goes out for a tour, he rehearses his set, and, you know, he has his, pretty much, has his show set up. So he's not accustomed to, you know, performing 50 or 60 songs and having them, you know, ready to roll all the time. So that was a big undertaking. It's a big undertaking for any performer to be able to know and be ready to sing 50 or 60 songs at any time.
And in a moment of weakness, because I'm already beat down by the pressures of debuting this other thing, I go, sounds good to me.
But he took it, you know, he looked at that challenge as something that he really wanted to do.
Challenge. Kevin the Challenger Shirley, that's his name. The great challenger.
And something that he never even thinks about.
Before you know it, I don't even think about it.
he rings up Anton and Michael, and they're in, and Lee with the horns and everything else, and I'm like going, okay, here we go.
Once we decided and we talked about this is something that, you know, sounds like an interesting idea, he embraced it immediately with no fear, no reservations, which I, of course, being his manager, I'm like, I had fear and reservations because I'm like, this is so much undertaking. Like, wow, you know, if we commit to this, we're going to have a lot of people, it's going to be a lot of money, it's going to be a lot of expense. Now we're kind of like, be careful for what you wish for because you just might get it.
Next thing I know, there's a set list. We're talking about set list. And I get this huge, he and I compile this huge list of songs. And it's January, and I said to myself, next time I'm going to pay for the lunch, and I'm going to get up off the table, and I'm going to walk away.
I think that the four shows are a tribute to his rise to stardom in London, from the small borderline club through, you know, the Albert Hall and selling out the Hammersmith, Apollo. And the fact that he sold out all four of these in 1 week is real testament to how wonderful London has been and wonderful England has been to the fans. And yeah, it's really a big thank you. So it's a bookend and a big thank you to the fans.
This week is really mostly a celebration of a couple of things. One is that it really all kind of started here. You know, the popularity, throughout the world at this point. And the other thing is, it's a celebration of the fans that have stuck with me since day one. Since I was, yes, playing the Borderline in front of 150 people. Yes, and when I was driving a splinter van or somebody else was driving it, or because I didn't know how to drive on the other side and would kill this all. And, it's a celebration of those fans that were there and have supported me throughout all the music that I've made in the last decade. As eclectic as it's been, they're still there. And so these shows are more for them than for me. And, because I know that those people that saw the three-piece night at the Borderline, I hope that they'll never forget that. And I proved something to myself that night as well, that I could still play in that fashion.
What is that? What about you back in the day? It's the same time. Like back, we should have flipped the slant.
Oh yeah.
Welcome, everybody. How are you guys feeling tonight, huh? Been a long time. Let me introduce Michael Rhodes on the bass, ladies and gentlemen. The great Anton Figg on the drums. My name is Joe Bonamassa. Thank you very much for coming to the Borderline. You guys are great.
Very cool.
I've known Kevin Shirley for many, many years. I don't know how many years ago it was, but he asked me to come and play on one of Joe's records. Could have been Slow Gin, I'm not sure. Anyway, but since then I've been playing on with Joe in the studio. And I did the Royal Albert Hall concert with him, a bunch of his albums. And then Kevin said that he wanted to do a you know, special event in London spanning all of Joe's career, and he wanted to get myself and Michael Rhodes to come down and play a certain portion of it, which reflected some of his early stuff.
This thing that we're over here doing here in London is, as I understand it, is sort of a you know, a retrospect view of his career, and so we're, you know, representing the early days. Anton Figg and I, and we're in this trio, you know, and so, which is the way Joe started, you know, and so it's a lot of fun.
And also, it would be a more of a jamming thing since we don't have the opportunity to play together. It's not like a super well rehearsed thing. We had a little rehearsal in LA, a little rehearsal yesterday, and we're just gonna go do it.
I picked the other musicians because I think that they're the very best at what they do. I think that Anton Figg is the best all-around drummer in the world, bar none. He can play rock, he can play jazz, he can play funk.
It's just amazing. You know, he is, there's nothing he can't do, you know. I just love playing with him, you know. It's just like, wow.
Why he was on the Borderline gig. I wanted that to be an especially challenging gig, almost like a prog rock gig, almost like a, you know, real progressive. And I know Joe can play that stuff. I know Anton can play that stuff. I know Michael Rhodes can play that stuff. So I got them because I think that they are the best in the world.
Michael, I played with actually in New York a few times, way back in the 90s. We played on a Rodney Crowell record together. He's just a really easy bass player to play with for me. You know, he's got like a lot of wisdom and history and musical understanding. And so, you know, when I play, it's just like, you know, I don't even think about the bass. It's just there and playing all the right stuff.
Playing bass is, I mean, it's not a glory position, not really. But it's, and you know, psychologically, one has to be suited to be okay with that. I like it. I mean, I call it being in the engine room. It's all about making somebody like Joe, the artist, the primary artist, or whoever, or making the song. And it's surrendering personality, and surrendering to the principle of the music. And whatever serves the music is most important. It's primary. But to get back to the engine room, we work in the engine room, so you know the artists can be on deck sunning themselves.
And then Joe is, you know, playing with Joe is like, he's sort of like a race car.
You know, the rising star of guitar, you know, one of the best.
He'll be playing and then he'll go into another gear and it'll just go up like that. And then you think, okay, that's it. And then all of a sudden he goes into overdrive. So it's like just having a really super finely tuned expensive racing car, which what I imagine, I don't have one myself, you know.
Playing with someone like Joe, who, and I think anyone who has accumulated a musical vocabulary, and it's a shared vocabulary the world over. I mean, music is the universal language. So when we get together and play, we're all drawing from the same source. The dialect and the accents may be a little bit different, but the essential language is the same, and so it creates this wonderful synergy. and ability to communicate in ways that even people that don't know each other personally that well can instantly communicate. And it's wonderful. And I think that speaks to Joe's ability to have these different numbers of musicians that are performing this week at different venues, and it starts small and it gets bigger and it's an acoustic thing, and there, and you've got, you know, these guys, these British musicians, and you get the, you know, and people from really kind of all over the world, and but they still speak the same language in small numbers and in large numbers, and it's a great thing, you know, and it's all about communication and it's all about listening, really. Essentially, it's about first listening and then responding rather than reacting.
Borderline, what stuck out to me, my favorite in the Borderline was Spanish Boots. We did a Jeff Beck cover, and it's off of the Beck Ola record. Now, the Beck Ola record, or Beck Ola, whatever you want to call it, it's a very strange album. It's like the Jeff Beck group is breaking up, but it's a classic album in the sense it's so ramshackle in its assembly that it works. You know, you're talking about a record that has two Elvis covers, a Nicky Hopkins piano solo piece with no band accompaniment, Spanish Boots, a song named Plinth, Water Down the Drain. I think it's seven tracks in total. I may be missing one, but that's the gist of the album. Opens up with All Shook Up, and then they do Jailhouse Rock. And Spanish Boots, to play it in London, a small club, the 59 Les Paul. And even my tech, Mike Hickey, said, you know, this takes you back to an era where these guys were on stage with these great guitars just playing this music that inspired us all. I mean, the reason why I play, you know, one of the big reasons why I want to play a Sunburst Les Paul is Jeff Beck, you know, with those old pictures at the Marquee Club with the cabinets that were stacked upside down. So you have the two slant cabinets and the 50-watt head, and he had this big tiger stripe Les Paul. You know, Paul Kossoff and, you know, Eric Clapton. And they all started here in London playing small places with these beautiful 59 Les Pauls.
Do you want to see something very cool? This could be the coolest thing ever. This here is a 1959 Les Paul, and it's one of the most famous Les Pauls in the world.